Exactly right now.
The latest rage for kids is driving parents and entire neighborhoods crazy.
The Lazlow Show.
How much money have you saved up?
A smoking starring.
Oh, yes, I got my pillows named after women.
Big Wayne.
I have a Britney after Britney Spears. And then I have a Linda after one of my good friend's wives.
And
who in this room has actually spoken with Paris Hilton?
That would be me.
Producer Reed Tucker.
You know? He has her damn number.
I have her cell phone.
Let's call it.
No, I don't have it with me.
What a great producer we have.
Oh, cut somebody. Oh, yeah.
The Lazlow Show.
Without a doubt, that's a picture. It should be taped right on the front of someone's door when he comes in tomorrow morning. Let him know we're breathing down his neck.
No, we are breathing down nobody's neck.
Episode 7 of The Lazlow Show. Thanks to Drew Boogie of The Opie and Anthony Show for part of the opening there. Just got off the phone with Opie there.
Things are looking good.
Yeah, he's doing all right. He said, good show, guys.
Thank you.
Good show. Today on The Lazlow Show, Chip Rowe, who is the Playboy advisor, also some anti-drug videos for Wayne to watch. Get you off the smack. And some rap music from Japan. Also, another Jaguar Skills adventure. And Hot Groove Mama, Big Les, will be on the program tonight. She stars in some of the Jaguar Skills adventures. And so since last week, we started off with Led Snooplin.
Who the hell he is? And it's cool that y'all can make it to my new meeting. So take your time, grab a table, we got booths seating. Now allow me introduce me to my new people. See, my name is Lyrics Mom, baby, and I truly mean it. From the past, from the future, from the new permission. You don't believe it, you can read it. Page one in your leaflet, L-Y-R-C-S-4, fill it for baby. I'm a fashion, I'm an MC, and I think on that topic, we all in agreement. I'm never running from a challenge, never been cheapish. In the rap hall of fame, we got to get me in. You got to see me do my thing, son, I'm too fiendish. Playing tune after tune till the wound deepens. I have a room of human beings feeling woozy like a fiend. And moving to the music and a fever screaming, baby. Calling out to all every group, we gon' make it all happen right here, right now. Calling out to all every group, we gon' make it all happen right here, right now. Calling out to all every group, we gon' make it all happen right here, right now. Calling out to all every group, we gon' make it all happen right here, right now. It's a culmination of my past achievements. With a lot of heavy lifting, a lot of deep breathing. A lot of courage, a lot of doubts, a lot of mixed feelings. A lot of love, a lot of luggage for a lot of reasons. I ain't forgot about the pain and all the mistreatment. I ain't forgot the little box they tried to wiggle me in. I ain't forgot about the flower deep underneath the crowded street. Sprouting in between the crack team and shouting, baby! Bottom like a lion in the Coliseum. And you can positive, I dig them in the mausoleum. You think I'll ever hang it up on money, stop dreaming. You think I'll ever stop, oh baby, now you're reaching. I won't stop till I feel my lungs stop breathing. I won't stop till I feel my heart stop beating. I won't stop speaking this week and next week and all fall asleep singing. I don't stop singing. Fire freezing, ice heating, fire bomb beating off that fall free clear from the mountaintop screaming, baby. Calling out to all every group, we gon' make it all happen right here, right now. Calling out to all every group, we gon' make it all happen right here, right now. I said, calling out to all every group, we gon' make it all happen right here, right now. Calling out to all every group, we gon' make it all happen right here, right now.
Get it on, 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 get
right here, right now.
It is the Lazlow Show. Here with sidekick Big Wayne. Wayne, it's your third show. You made it thus far.
Yeah, but last week was almost a disaster.
Almost. If I didn't hit the stupid dump button.
I'm going to try better.
Thank God we're in delay.
I hear you.
Reed Wayne's been working on words instead of profanity words all week.
Substitutes?
Yeah.
What you got? Hit me.
It's just spur of the moment to swap them out.
Swap them out.
Good.
Tonight on the show, here in a little bit, we're going to talk to Chip Rowe, who, like everybody writes into Playboy magazine with their problems. Like, my wife is dating another man. What should I do? My stereo's broken. And he answers. So I have him on a little bit. Wayne was at the house this weekend installing the new door of the Radio Lazlow compound.
And a new storm door. And we're like celebrities on his street.
Dude, people are now coming up to Wayne. He's been on the radio 3 times. They're coming up to him, inviting him to block parties.
All you can eat extravaganzas.
You already got a sponsorship. We've been rotting in the studio.
We're working on that still.
I think the sponsorship has fallen through because I called the...
You're dropping a bomb on me.
Well, because I spoke to the person at that company.
Yeah.
And, realize that in these days, video game companies have got enough problems without having to explain to Congress what Big Wayne's romantic moments are.
I can understand that.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
Are we going to have a romantic moment later, Wayne?
I'll try and see if I can bring one up for you.
Well, we should bring Chip Rowe on the show so that we can start talking about swinging. Are you there, Chip?
I'm here.
Okay, now... how long have you been the Playboy advisor?
I have been the Playboy advisor for almost 11 years.
Wow, and it's one of those things like the baton gets handed down.
That's right. There's only been maybe 5 guys in the 50-plus year history of the magazine that's done it. And I think it's because it's a difficult job to give up. It's a lot of fun, and every month, you know, we get 500 or 600 letters. And I get a little concerned that there won't be something in there I haven't answered already. And yet there's always 20 letters that are just like, oh, my God, I couldn't have thought that anyone would write that.
Don't you worry about humanity? Because I read the letters that you answer, and I'm like, what is wrong with people?
Well, I never have gotten that pessimistic about it because I look at it like these people have the courage, I guess, to try to solve this problem. And often they're sex problems, and so there's not a lot of other places to write to. Where you just, you don't want to go to a doctor about it. And
yeah, why not broadcast your troubles to all of humanity?
Well, you just have to put your initials on it. I do have situations where I get letters from people in small towns, and they're about some strange fetish or so forth, where I'll just change the, town to a bigger city nearby, because I'm thinking they're not really thinking about this, and it shows up in Playboy with their initials in the small town they live in, people are going to kind of figure that out.
But maybe they want that kind of attention.
Yeah, maybe they want that kind of attention.
Yeah, it could be.
That's their way of coming out of the closet.
Yeah, could be.
Now, when I first met you, you were reading my newsletter on my website.
Yeah.
And you contacted me and said, are you interested in starting to write for Playboy? And at first, I thought it was going to be the greatest thing ever.
Yeah.
Except... everybody's got the same stupid, lame comment when you tell them that you've...
Nobody reads Playboy?
Right. How tired are you of that?
Yeah, joke. I read it for the articles, you mean?
It's so annoying.
Yeah, yeah.
Somebody reads the articles?
The people that say that I find aren't Playboy readers, because the people who read the magazine understand that there's truth to the joke, so they don't find it that funny anymore.
What percentage do you think are readers?
People who are regular subscribers and stuff generally are like, when I meet those people, they'll say, I like this part and this part, and I like the advisor, but you're an idiot, because last month you said this to this guy, and that was totally wrong.
Any death threats? Because, I'm sure you've broken up a few relationships since you're Mr. Expert.
I have only gotten death threats from prisoners who want to get in touch with the Playmates. So when I used to interview Playmates and write up the little captions and the copy that would go with the pictorial, they would write me and say, it'd be best for you to send me her home number.
Or they'll kill you.
Yeah, or I'm going to get out. Here's my release date, and I know where you work. But,
speaking of where you work, Reed and I were thinking about coming by and maybe recording some kind of audio history of of what it's like at the Playboy building in New York, and I called you, and you told me it was lame.
Yeah, it is. I mean, the place to be is the mansion and the Los Angeles office, because that's where all the women come in to be photographed, and of course the mansion has all the parties. The offices in New York are strictly, you know, the editorial, the text. That's where all the articles are created. So it's just cubicles and offices. And once in a while, when you get, you know, Playmates on Stern or something, she'll come around the corner and visit. and that kind of thing. But most of the time, it's just us pumping out words.
Yeah, you said that, like, high school kids will come by.
Yeah,
like,
there's a placard, you know, there's a placard on Fifth Avenue that just says Playboy. And so you really have to fight the crowd because it's across from Trump Tower, so there's always these buses stopping and people getting off. That's sort of where they let the tourists off. But there's always a crowd of people gathered around this placard taking photos of themselves in front of the word Playboy. And, you know, so you the high school kids, I've seen this like five times. It's sort of becoming amusing. There's a, you know, there'll be a group of high school boys walking along, and they'll stop, and they'll do a little powwow, and they'll look at it, and they'll talk back and forth, and then they'll send one guy into the, you know, inside to find out what's going on, and of course they get to the security guard who says you can't come in. But I don't know what they expect. You know, are they expecting they'll go in and the security guard will say, oh, we were just hoping there'd be a group of 17-year-old boys here so we could have you help with the photo shoot.
Right.
Just come on in, because we need a bunch of you in the sand in the back.
Right, we were just hoping to have a few people that are not sexually experienced at all.
Yeah, and, you know, we want you to yell stuff at her as we're taking the photos.
And when I first...
woo-hoo, like that, you know, that'd be great.
When I first met you, you had just come back from a swinger convention...
Yeah, an orgy.
In Chicago.
Yeah, I think that... Was that the first one or the second one?
Oh, I didn't know you'd been to two swinger conventions.
I get them mixed up. I get them mixed up, you know, where I saw this weird thing happen, whether it was the 1 year or the second year, I can't remember.
I was just doing some research, and I found out you were one of the keynote speakers at the swingers convention.
Yeah, I was the keynote speaker the first year, and then they liked me so much, they said I could come back and bring a friend the next year.
Bring a friend,
yeah.
Nice.
And the problem was, and is, well, not really a problem, but...
You're married, would be the problem.
Right? And so, I told my wife, well, I have to go to this orgy, and I'm the keynote speaker, and of course, it took a little while to convince her of that, and then they paid me in, like, $20 bills, because they collected 20s at the door for admission, you know?
How many $20 bills?
Passed them on to me, but I gave the keynote, and it was like, afterwards, they all were having dinner, and everybody was, you know, a couple of people stood up and flashed me, and it was all in good fun. And then afterwards, I went upstairs in the hotel. It was in a hotel they had rented. And there was like a whole floor they blocked off with security on either end. And just every room was somebody doing something crazy.
And with the doors open, right?
Yeah. If they had the doors open, I got the whole lowdown from the person. Because usually I felt very privileged because generally you have to be in a couple to get into these swinger orgies.
Yeah, they don't like...
I was a single guy. And they had this escort who supposedly took me up there. But then he disappeared.
So it was
just
you.
Around.
Now, did people yell out at you, like, hey, come on in?
Well, there'd be, like, nude women come up to me and say, I really enjoyed your talk.
Nice.
And I was like, wow, thank you, you know. And it was really difficult because I think the lesson I learned from it was, you know, these weren't all 22-year-old, you know, blonde, big-breasted women.
Now, see, here's my impression of swingers.
Yeah.
They're all fat, middle-aged, and creepy.
Well... There were some of those, but it was a mix. I always said it's like if you were walking through LaGuardia.
Ugh.
And you just said the first 400 couples that walked by you.
So there's a fat...
put them in a room. Yeah, but there'd be some, but then there'd be some hot ones, some young ones, you know, 20s, 30s, all the way to 80. You know, there's just, that was all over the place.
There's a fat Pakistani man with 800 boxes and a lot of luggage?
Yeah, just imagine him naked.
Now, and weren't there contests of who could sleep with the most hotel employees or something?
Well, I was talking to these women about it, and it was interesting because at the beginning of the night, I was like, well, you know, she's like 40 and, you know, got a couple kids and, you know, I'm not really drawn to her. But by the, you know, after 20 minutes of talking to her, I'd be like, wow, she'd be a lot of fun. And so it was really interesting over the course of the night how the immediate judgment you make of somebody's looks kind of went away because you realized this was somebody who loved sex, who was very open and fun, and, you know, you got in more into it. But they would, I would ask them, like, because there was a lot of the hotel employees there around the edges, and they had all sort of knew what was going on. It wasn't any big secret. And security guards. And so I was asking one woman in particular, you know, how do you interact with these people from the outside? And she said, well, if we find a cute one, we kind of go over and hit on him, and, you know, maybe he gets a little special treat somewhere in the bathroom at 1 a.m. in the morning.
Nice.
So, like, so I was like, this is the life.
Now you
I couldn't do anything. I was, you know, I told my wife, she let me go, but I couldn't obviously touch anybody or do anything. So that was sort of frustrating, but also interesting because it gave, it kind of let me wander around and not feel, you know, obligated.
What's the most frequently asked question that you get? People writing in letters to the Playboy Advisor?
Well, it's the penis question. I mean, you've asked it many times.
Yeah, I know.
Yes.
How do I make it bigger? And
how do I make it bigger?
They all want, like, you know, what is it? Can you give me a surgeon? Or are these pills, the pills that I see on the internet work? And, you know, basically the answer is you're probably normal. The normal is 4 to 6 inches.
When?
Okay.
After you're aroused. And so, you know, all this stuff isn't, one, it's not necessary, two, it doesn't work. And you don't, you know, I did a piece once on the surgery, and some guys came out of the surgery with a shorter.
Oh, my God.
So.
Yeah, I've heard people go into, like, Mexico and Peru.
For sex changes. The guys who write me, they don't do it. They don't write and say, well, I want to do this so I'll be a better lover and my wife or girlfriend will be happier. They basically say, well, when I go to the gym and I'm changing in the locker room,
right,
I want the other guys to look over and, you know, see how large I am.
I'm like that.
And I'm like, that's the stupidest thing I've ever heard, you know? To go under the knife for that or spend $100 a month on these worthless pills.
Now, I was at your website. When your apartment got broken into,
This is my personal site, you mean?
Your chipro.com.
Yeah.
When your apartment got broken into, you must have had a stash of Playboy stuff that all got taken.
Yeah. Oh, everything.
Oh.
Yeah, they took all my porn, and that was a really, you know, you can take my money and my computer and my photographs and the gifts I got for high school graduation, but don't take my porn.
That's pretty.
You know, just leave that there.
That's pretty, and then
because that's very special to me, and I chose that very carefully.
Not only did they take your porn, they opened up your fridge.
Oh yeah, they ate my food
and ate your food.
They used the toilet. Yeah, they did the whole deal. But you know, I think the lingering effect it had on me was really the porn, because some of those I haven't been able to replace. Like, you know, there was a scene in one of them with a redhead in a apron and all that. I've never been able to find that redhead in the apron scene again.
Now,
and that's the stuff that affects you.
Now, since we have you on the phone, have you ever heard of a fetish? It happens to be one that my sidekick Wayne here has, about girls with undeveloped arms.
Undeveloped,
you know, like
amputees? Shorter arms than her body.
Shorter and smaller hand than her body size.
like a baby arm.
I have to tell you, I've researched and done many stories and articles on fetishes and talked to many people with interesting sexual interests, and I've never heard that.
Wow, dude, you stumped the advisor.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, you got such issues.
There's a new one you can work on.
Like a difficult, just seems so difficult to find that
small-handed person.
Circumstance.
How about an albino fetish? You ever heard of that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You have?
Yeah.
Wow. We may have to try to get him back on the show.
Not like it's really popular. Most of what I get now is foot fetish. It's really odd.
I'm down that road myself.
So I've been getting a lot of foot fetish letters.
I think it was 9/11. I blame
really
it.
Really think? Because there's a study that shows that foot fetishism kind of peaks as people become more stressed. This guy did a study back to the 18th century and, you know, studied erotic literature and found feet started appearing more and more whenever there was a war or something.
Wow.
So, and maybe you're on to something.
Every time...
I just can't be into feet. It's got to be all that, right?
Every time I see some of the stuff you write for Playboy, besides the advisors, it's kind of like civil rights, privacy rights, and I saw something that you would track down how many people had been arrested for shooting a cop the finger.
Oh, yeah, right. This is all related. I mean, I think when you talk about privacy rights, sexual freedom, First Amendment, all that stuff is, it's all intertwined, you know, and obviously Playboy's take is that more sexual freedom is good and sex education is good and privacy is good. And I just had noticed in the free speech we write about a lot, I'd read about a guy who was arrested for flipping off a cop.
Like a high school, there was one high school kid
in
the bus.
Yeah, it was like, I think it's a case I found initially, the guy had driven by a cop going the other way and he just flipped him off. Didn't like police officers. You know, I don't know, who knows the backstory, but... But I thought, well, that's interesting. I wonder if there's any, like, other cases like that. And so I searched some databases and legal databases, and I found probably 60 cases where people had been arrested for flipping cops off. And so I just pulled some out, and it was really fascinating. Like, one was a kid in the back of a school bus, and the cop had stopped behind it, flipped him off. So the cop got out of the school bus and busted the kid. And another was, like, this guy complained about police helicopters flying over his house, and so one day the police helicopter just like swooped down right over his house for like 10 minutes, you know, like 50 feet above him or something, and the guy flipped him off, so they arrested him
for flipping off a helicopter.
Meanwhile, the police chopper is, you know, hovering over his house just to bug him and blow everything all over the place. So he got acquitted, but there was some really fascinating stuff. An American Airlines pilot who flipped off a security camera in Brazil got busted, fined $10,000.
For flipping off a camera?
Yeah, they said it was, he insulted the intelligence of Brazilians.
Well,
yeah, that
come
was
on.
The charge or something like that.
Insulting the intelligence of Brazilians?
Yeah. Yeah, it was literally something like that.
Do they have electricity down there?
So that cost him. Yeah, but there was a guy actually who was executed lethal injection in Missouri, I believe, who flipped off the warden as he died.
Well, and then see, that's kind of cool.
Yeah,
I thought that was, you know, like that.
I guess he wasn't sorry. So
that is excellent. Well, I have to tell you, Chip, we were reading Playboy on the train on the way in, and Wayne was not impressed with some of your responses.
Oh, that's fine. That's fine. You know,
well, I was just quite surprised
Wayne
that
can take a leap.
Whoa, Wayne!
I was just quite surprised that, you know, someone.
No, that's fine. I get a lot of letters from people who say you're an idiot. Basically,
well, I wasn't saying you were an idiot. I was saying
but that's the, you know, that's the you got it wrong. You did it. But all I can say is that's not right. What I have to say is the correct answer. And I'd be happy to publish your letter, but I'll always have the last word.
How does that work with your wife, Mr. I know everything about sex?
I kind of got to keep my voice down.
Because you're at home right now.
Yeah, because if she hears me, then I'll have to hang up.
How many of your friends have pulled you aside and said, dude, don't tell anybody about this, but I've got a question. I need a little help. Do a lot of people look at you like a therapist?
Well, my friends don't, because what's odd is that people I don't even know at parties will find out what I do and suddenly go into this very intimate discussion of their sex life and what they like and don't like. I mean, really specific about body parts and things, you know. And I just kind of nod. It's like I'm a priest, and this is finally somebody they can confess to. And I just nod, and if it's interesting, I try to get them to write me an email, you know. Tell, you know, ask me a question in the email so I can print it and, you know, answer it.
Well, we're going to have to send you some of Big Wayne's romantic moments. He every show shares with us different sexual things to...
Fantasies.
Yeah, like...
Well, one rule I have is I don't want to gross anybody out.
Well, he's got some that are pretty gross, I got to say.
In the column, you know.
Yeah. Well, actually... We'll get to your pillow thing later.
Usually I try to answer questions that involve another human being.
Wayne names his pillows.
Oh, really?
Yeah, have you ever heard of that one?
No. Are they female names?
Of course.
Are they, do you like dress the pillows up?
No, there's not that
just
much.
Regular, like in white?
Yeah, it's because I'm a humper, if you know what I'm saying.
Hold on, I gotta play, I have to play his theme music.
Romantic Moments with Big Wayne.
So I'm like a humper, you know. I got one pillow that has to, you know, go between my legs, and as the night goes on,
yeah,
I end up dry humping it.
Yeah. Do you ever thought of maybe buying like a different color pillowcase for one of them to give them different personalities.
My wife hooks me up with that. I have multiple pillowcase colors.
Really?
Yes, and multiple sizes.
Because they could be like different races. You could have a purple one, a blue one, and a white one.
I think he sticks with white.
Yeah.
Really?
Irish Catholic women.
Okay, so these are virgin pillowcases.
In theory, yes.
Yeah, no birth control users or anything like that among the pillowcases.
Thanks for being on the show.
Thank you.
And we'll talk to you soon. This is the Lazlow Show on K-Rock. Night 2-3 K-Rock, it's the Lazlow Show. Wayne, you've been working on your radio voice this week.
A little bit there, and the guy that's on before us, he digs deep. And next here on K-Rock, Nick Carter.
He's a very nice guy.
He's a wonderful guy, but...
Jeff Berlin.
Is he really?
Yeah, he knows everybody in the radio industry.
That's cool.
You got to get a radio voice. You'll be like, hey, everybody, it's Wayne the Carpenter.
I like my regular voice. Now, I'm getting compliments on it, too.
So you're a carpenter by day, and like your carpenter buddies say, hey, I can't, you know.
Yeah, they all think this is a big financial windfall over here.
Well, they should know that these studios suck.
So does the pay scale.
They should know that Reed, this useless producer, came with
that. Yeah, what's going on with that tonight?
Every radio station I've been to in America, and even a couple in Canada, has headphones in the studio.
Yeah, that's true.
Right? In front of each microphone, there are headphones, except at K-Rock.
Yep, one set of headphones, the pair I got on.
And so, you know, and I've got my own, but we've got guests coming by.
Which at your professional level, you should have your own.
But there's no headphones. And Reed, the stupid producer, forgot his.
Well, he's out jetting across the city right now.
On his...
picking up a couple pair.
Faggy moped. How do you feel about Reed tooling around on that little moped?
I don't know. Well, actually, I think that's pretty cool.
I think it's sissy,
I think he
dude.
Needs to step up to
he
one a little bigger,
up.
But... I got to tell you, they're a lot of fun.
So the website is lazlow.com. You can listen to past episodes there and see how we sucked even worse.
And any fan mail you want to send to Big Wang, you send it on down through Lazlo. My fan base.
We do have a lot of stuff coming in. Here's one from Justin Simon. Says, man, I tell you, with all the negative stuff going... And he doesn't say stuff. He says the word that you used last week, and I hit it.
Stuff is a good word.
He said, all the negative stuff going on in the world, it's sure nice break to have a show like yours to listen to. We can't get the signal here in Canada, obviously, but we're... Because they've... and also in Canada, they can only have, like, half French programming or something.
Exactly.
We can't get the signal here in Canada, obviously, but we're hooked on the MP3 archives you guys are posting. Just please don't get kicked off the air. We need you, a loyal Canadian fan. Smoke long and prosper, he says.
Alrighty, excellent.
He dug listening
little
to
Amsterdam.
And another one here from Ashley.
Nice.
Dude, the show rocks. I listen to it off your site every week. Any possibilities of a live stream? I've never understood, you know, they've got that K-Rock 2 thing here.
Right.
Why isn't it just simulcasting the signal? It's like a whole different station.
That's not my end.
Here's one. I don't, Wayne, dude, your show rocks. This is from Richard. From Boo Pig is his name, I guess, in this email. Dude, your show rocks. Holy shucks. But he didn't say shucks. My microwave just beeped. I forgot I had something in there. Anyway, here's an attached pic. Can I be a guest? Let's see who that...
No.
Do you know who that is?
No.
That's Carrot Top.
Is it?
I think we got an email from Carrot Top. I don't...
That's amazing.
And then he says he'd like to come on the show and talk about how people can download porn for free.
Let's do it.
How do we really know it's Carrot Top, dude?
That's Carrot Top, I'm telling you.
Well, I know that's a picture, but that's just like when you were online with all the Pregos that you like.
Yeah, well.
Then, you know, do you send them your real picture, a fat guy with no shirt, dreadlock beards down to his waist?
That wasn't working.
The big Dutch master?
They definitely wouldn't have been responding back.
Well, hopefully Reed will hurry up with those.
Reed, if you're picking this up, a couple Red Bulls.
You're fired.
The Red Bull refrigerator was empty this week.
Well, it's because they heard that you were in the green room over there. You're not supposed to be doing
that. Oh, really?
We ain't following any rules here, Wayne. There's radio rules.
I didn't know about them.
Later on the show, Big Les is coming in, and Jaguar Skills Adventure, as well as some anti-drug PSAs and instructional videos.
I'm sure in this station that's going to take a lot of effect.
That we'll watch This is the Lazlow Show. We'll be back in a bit.
Hello?
Hi, is Mark there?
Yeah?
It's me, Shannon. We met at Jack's party.
Yeah, how can I forget? Wow, how you doing? I haven't heard from you in,
9 months. Hello?
Some moments change your life. San Andreas Telephone, for those difficult conversations.
Built from cheap labor from Zambia, El Salvador, and Paraguay. This is the one and only.
Who is he?
Lazlow.
You understand?
Hey, either K-Rock.
That sucks. Come on, and you know somewhere there was a guy sitting at a red light, like playing the drums. You're looking in your rearview mirror like, what the heck is up with that guy?
I love, do you ever play air guitar, Wayne?
Yeah, I had a whole concert on Friday night with my wife. For 3 hours, my neighbor must think I'm off the wall.
Now, see, you told me that you were going to get her liquored up and bang her, and yeah. Then she calls me at home.
That was your incentive you sent me home with.
And then she calls me, and I say, what are you doing? You're supposed to be liquored up right now.
Wow. It was a good liquor session and a concert session that at one point we literally were singing at the wall to our neighbor just to like really just like tweak him a little bit.
Yeah, you hate your neighbor?
No, we love our neighbor. We only do it a couple times a year, but it gets a little crazy. This, you know.
You know, I think Reed forgot his headphones on purpose, dude. I think he's trying to sabotage the show.
I don't know. He might have trouble getting back in the building.
I get my pass.
Yeah, well, there was almost a malfunction when we came in.
That's true. He's probably visiting his girlfriend, Yoko Ono.
Yep, Yoko.
Trying to break up the band.
Trying to get between, who is it, John and Paul?
Trying to get between me and you.
You were
on the show one time. And
it sent her into a tizzy.
I don't know. I'm not sure it was her. But
I hope when I meet her, she at least has the decency to let me, you know, be my personality and she enjoy it.
Anyway, we can't
no
talk.
No more Zeppelin.
No, okay. So, now, Wayne, on the beach yesterday, you were telling me something that had me go find some anti-drug material because I'm a little concerned about you. Because right. I said, most people when they're young will try to, you know, hide the liquor and drugs
exactly.
from their parents.
Well, I got caught a couple too many times smoking the weed in the house. And my parents eventually, you know, came to this conception that it was safer to do in their environment rather than out in the public where you could get arrested for it.
So you just fire one up in front of mom?
Well, you know, after a while, you know, just, you know, be at the Thanksgiving Day table and kind of
Thanksgiving
like,
Day.
Thanksgiving Day, the family would be gathered around.
Now, how many family members?
A couple nieces and nephews, my sister and a husband.
Anybody, like any young kids?
Yeah, when the young kids were around, though, I had to leave the room and then go into my own room, which was then created the Uncle Wayne smell.
Uncle Wayne smell.
And this one of them definitely remembers the smell, I'm sure.
Some of the kids are like, God, when they get into high school.
But
like,
the best part was I'd come back and sit down.
How come
and smoke.
The hippie smells like Uncle Wayne?
I'd be smoking and I'd go to pass to my sister. She'd be like, no, I can't do it in front of mom and dad. I'm like, come on, they know you do it. Right now, her kids are listening. And I hope that's not
you know
a problem.
What, you know what drugs lead to, Wayne?
Yes.
All reefer leads to H.
Yes.
You ever done H?
No. Yes. Yes.
See?
Yes.
Listen to this.
They all lead.
Listen.
Youth is a time for fun, pranks, and jokes. Of ice cream cones and chocolate sodas.
Swinging.
Youth is a time for getting
a job. Being on this.
For finding one's place in the world. But sometimes, in these troubled days, the very thoughtlessness of youth has led to a living nightmare. Addiction to drugs.
It's not music. Music.
What's that?
I'm itching right now.
H. H? What's H? That's a lot. It's heroin. Will it make me sick like the reefers did?
Marty's story is like many of the others. It started with marijuana cigarettes.
See, come on, it's my turn next. Gee, Duke, where'd you get him?
I know a guy.
Three for a buck.
Let me try.
Wow, three
for a buck.
He
was determined to be one of the gang if it killed him. And it almost did. Several weeks later, after smoking reefers. Marty's befogged brain hit on a clever way to open pop bottles.
smashing pop bottles and drinking from them.
Later, yeah. Stan went to the hospital for swallowing broken glass. Mm-hmm. Marty badly cut the inside of his mouth, though he didn't even know it at the time.
He's so high.
Before long, Marty was hooked, physically dependent on heroin. Nothing mattered but the ever-present craving for the drugs. He had given up interest in everything else.
See, Wayne? Maybe you could have been like a nuclear physicist instead of a carpenter.
No, I was destined to be a carpenter because you can smoke weed and be a carpenter.
Reed, you're back. We were just we were just defaming you. Did you hear any of it?
Dissing me on the air.
Yep. The producer has returned.
With goodies.
So there was, what'd you bring?
Some headphones, a movie for you, some snacks.
Excellent.
All the good stuff.
So I did some more research, and I found the very first scientific test where they had scientists in a room testing marijuana
on monkeys.
Stop with the racial stuff.
That wasn't racial.
It was, too. They already did it in the first hour. And so they get this guy, and I guess they had like liquid THC in a vat or something. And an hour goes by, and you see the video, and he's sitting on this, like, in the scientific room with this big, goofy look on his face, and they ask him how he's doing.
Well, Bill, it's been about 2 hours since you got the drug. How do you feel?
Fantastic.
That's how I feel.
Fantastic. And they start showing him some flashcards with different words on it, Reed. Like, you know, how do you respond to these words? Do you feel this way? And then ask him if he is interested in participating in a study again where he gets to get stoned, you know, for science.
Defiant? Not at all.
Not defiant?
Business-like? Not at all.
Correct.
Sheesh. Friendly.
Yeah.
Extreme.
Would you be interested in taking part in a study like this again and having the same type of drug?
Sure.
You would. It's been a very pleasant experience for you.
I'll do it anytime you want.
Do you think it would be
any time at all?
Do you think
just
it would be
call me any time of the day or night?
We found out that the drug makes people happy. It makes them intoxicated, and finally makes them sleepy, which is about what marijuana users were telling us happened all the time.
Broke too.
What?
Usually broke too.
You know, they say that like it leads to heroin. Oh, it leads to Wendy's.
Pretty, yes, it does.
Leads to munching.
Now, and all the time you know me, have you ever seen me sitting around mumbling like that?
Well, the one time that a friend of ours brought you a hookah.
Yes, well, that was insane. I was in that kayak imagining crazy things.
He blew up a Heineken kayak and dragged it out in the street. And
laid in it, eating M&Ms.
In the middle of the street, in a blown up Heineken kayak that he sort of half blew up.
Yeah, it wasn't fully blew up.
Right.
When I climbed in it. Do you remember what I said I felt like I was in?
Is a fat guy with a dreadlock beard down to his waist, rowing around in it, eating M&Ms. What were you saying?
I don't know if I can say that on the air. What I felt like when I was in.
I think I do remember that, and we will not be saying it on the air. It is a Lazlow show. I guess I can fade out the 80-minute Metallica song. What do you think, Reed?
It goes on for another 22 after that.
Yeah, I know. I like Metallica, though.
Yeah. So
this is the Lazlow Show.
Name a song you like.
Huh?
Name a song you like.
Well, I've got, Reed, last week we almost played the new song by the Bloodhound Gang, because I'm buddies with those guys since like 95. I've known them. And I was talking to Lupus, the bass player, and he said, I'm going to send you the song. We just finished it. It's called Foxtrot Uniform Charlie Kilo, and the whole song is like funny ways of describing different relations.
I'm not going there.
And I almost played it last week, and then my Spidey sense went off, and I didn't. And so then I call Mr. Music Director Guy here named Mike on Monday, and he said a memo went out to stations nationwide, Infinity stations, that said, do not play that song at all.
Good thing.
So it's a good thing.
Yeah.
Well, they did kick me down another tune. They had to find a new single.
Did you post that on the website so people could download
it? No, but actually, if you go to bloodhoundgang.com, they've got the song, and the video is hysterical. They took a car and modified it to look like a big banana, and they just are driving through the countryside and going through tunnels.
Excellent. I love it.
And then they've got like girls in bikinis with power tools, like big jackhammers, so the girls are vibrating around.
Look at every video needs.
Crazy bracelets you got over there.
I'm taking them off.
Big Les. So I've never met Big Les in person. I have only talked to her on the phone. If you've listened to our show, shame on you. But if you've listened to this show, the Jaguar Skills Adventures that we've done, which are sort of short radio serials about a British ninja DJ and his girlfriend. And his girlfriend was Big Les. And how I got introduced to Big Les is I called my boy Jay Wright, who is in charge of like urban programming or something at Sirius Satellite. And I said, I need like a really groovy soul mama. And he goes, you got to call Big Les then.
Soul mama number one in the house.
He did not even flinch. So I call her up and it was like I was back in the 70s talking to you on the phone.
Okay, what's up, man?
So now you actually worked at a radio station here in New York.
I did. I used to work at Hot 97.
Okay.
And then bounced to L.A. and did, Power with my man Big Boy, and then moved over to Middays, and then hit up Steve Harvey and was doing his show for these last couple of years.
So then you were on the Steve Harvey show. Here's what was weird, Reed. The Steve Harvey show was in L.A., on an urban station, and it was simulcast to Dallas,
right,
like 2 hours earlier. So, which I didn't even know they play urban music in Dallas at all.
Oh, yeah. There's black folks in Dallas.
Are there?
They love their hip-hop.
Well, I'm from Oklahoma, and I tell you.
Trust me, it's there, and it's crazy. Those hours were ugly. We had to be in the studio by like 3:30 in the morning because of the time difference from the West Coast. So, you know, here I am. I have to cover all the red carpet stuff, coming in, crawling in from like midnight, 1 o'clock, no shower, you know, residue from the party the night before, tequila on my breath, trying to get straight, come into work, handle my business, and then still, instead of doing a four-hour shift, be ripe and ready for when we go live in LA at 6 o'clock. So it's crazy, man, but hey, cha-ching.
So
cha-ching, that's what I'm hoping for.
Amen.
Wayne here,
you share something big.
Hey, Wayne.
I'm Big Wayne.
Hey, Big Wayne.
All right.
Hey. Wayne is sort of my sidekick. He's been on three shows. And I've already had to hit the delay dump button a couple of times.
Once.
Yeah.
Once.
Watch those fines.
But I was looking around, and I don't know if you've ever seen in Europe and in Asia, they keep trying to like front and take our hip hop style. Like, have you ever heard like German rap?
Oh, let me tell you, the rap overseas, whether you're in Switzerland, Sweden, Africa, Japan, is crazy. They all have albums, singles, and the clubs are bananas. Let me just give a little backdrop for those who don't know. I'm the girl who dances like on the beginning of Living Single or in the Remember the Time video. So I used to choreograph and dance over in Japan. They don't speak a lick of English. They know every word to every single, whether it's hip-hop, Mariah Carey, rock song, and they can dance their butts off. Dreadlocks, no English, love the American culture.
I downloaded a rap song that's popular right now in Japan, and I gotta say, I'm not digging it. Here's a little bit. I know.
That's a Pharrell produced track, so hopefully he's getting a check for that.
That was the best thing I've ever heard.
That is terrible, dude.
No, I loved it. I want to know what he's saying. You got a translation?
He's saying
he's going to cap a fool.
He's saying he's going to cap a fool, and then he's going to go buy a mobile phone that he can watch TV on.
Now, can you see the videos with the subtitles on the bottom? That's going to be crazy, right?
You know what I love is when they pirate American stuff and they try to do the subtitles at the bottom, like that Star Wars, where they had a pirated version of Star Wars, and they had the subtitles at the bottom. They had them all messed up. What was Star Wars called?
Like Revenge of the Salad Bar or something. Right. It was like something so wrong. I don't even know what it was.
It was terrible.
So what's the point? But Big Les was telling me earlier she's real tight with Bobby and Whitney.
Oh, listen, how much is crack?
No, let me tell you something. I used to dance with Bobby and Whitney on Bobby's like last two albums, Humping Around and all that stuff. So if you ever see the videos, I'm in there.
Are they swingers?
He swings on anything. She, you know, Whitney's not sharing her man. She's very clear about that. And you'll see I danced in the I'm Every Woman video with Whitney Houston and stuff, and spent many a times on the road. And if you think that Bobby is real ghetto and just jacked up, you got it wrong. Whitney's worse than Bobby is. Trust
and these are your friends you're talking about.
I love them dearly.
Really?
You know, and she might be meeting me downstairs, you know, ready to scratch my eyes out. But then, you know, we'll be at the bar throwing back shots of tequila. That's my girl. But she is. She's straight up ghetto gangster from Jersey. She doesn't take any mess. Don't look at her man because she will cut you. And
damn.
I'm telling you, it's the truth. Whatever you are seeing on that Bobby and Whitney show is the truth.
I haven't seen a lick of it. I try not to watch TV.
Yeah, I've only read about it. There's some bad stuff that goes down.
It's crazy, and they're not even showing you half of it. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? They're keeping it kind of PG for you.
That's the stuff that they're willing to put on TV. Have you heard the part about how Bobby is going to help Whitney out with her constipation?
Oh, yes, I did. No, we can't talk about that stuff.
Oh, yeah. They don't hold anything back. I'm telling you. Yeah, but I mean, even back in the day when Whitney was pregnant and stuff, you know, Bobby has admitted he's been, you know, running around doing his thing, you know, messing with girls in other cities. And I've seen him put chicks off on the bus in the middle of a truck stop. We could be driving from like Idaho to, you know, Albuquerque, New Mexico.
You're out here.
And once he was finished with her, he's like, all right, let's go take off. And she'd be standing there in the parking lot looking crazy.
At the truck stop.
At the truck stop.
Get her all jacked up on some kind of.
At the truck stop, gone. That's it. Yeah.
Now, did you talk to her about when she got stopped for pot at the airport?
I know she had it. You know, we know, and it's not the first time, and she probably had a lot more other stuff.
No. Did you ever smoke with Whitney?
No, I never smoked with Whitney.
I would.
I drank with her, but I don't smoke. So.
Are they blunt people?
Yeah, they're everything people.
How do they stay married? That's
everything
what I
people.
Know.
They've been married longer than everybody.
Yeah, that's what I don't get.
Because they're codependent on each other, man. Yeah. You know, he lights her pipe, she lights his. You know what I'm saying? He carries the stash, he's got the bail money, it's all good. They balance each other out.
How is she making any money, though? I don't get it.
You forget she owns
she's
all
living off
of
those
her
royalties
publishing.
On that
exactly.
Songs,
before
man.
Her father passed away, he made sure that she got all of her publishing off of all those songs. So, cha-ching, she's richer than rich.
Who's her aunt?
Dionne Warwick.
Yeah, so she lost a lot of money. So somewhere, someone in the family learned how to keep the money coming.
Yep. So.
Well, pretty soon we'll be playing a Jaguar Skills Adventure so we can hear we can hear Big Les in action. What else she got, Reed?
I talked to her for like 5 minutes in the other room, and my ears were bleeding. Her stories were so good.
I know. You just dropped the bomb on me about Suge Knight getting shot.
Yeah, did you guys hear this?
Suge Knight?
Crazy. Down in Miami at the VMAs.
Yeah.
But you know what? I'm not surprised he didn't get off in jail. I'm not surprised that it didn't happen sooner. Suge Knight, I don't care, will turn any man who works for him into a punk. And you kind of know that going into it, you know, because you're getting money or fringe benefits and stuff like that. But there's only so much one man can take when you humiliate him in front of his mama or in front of his girl, and then that's the person who's going to take you out. Not somebody who's jealous and envious of you, but somebody who's on your payroll who you just pissed off for the last time, who's got access to you and is going to off you in your living room while you're sitting there having a beer.
Speaking of offing, I'm getting a little nervous because you used to work for Hot 97, and there's always shootings, and you dissing Suge Knight, you're going to be some fools downstairs.
Reed, you pat her down when she came in?
Really?
Come it's your
on,
job.
She's strapped, yeah. I tell you.
You have a pat down, a chocolate mama?
You go, Reed.
In my dreams, baby, every night.
This is the Lazlow Show. K Rock, it is the Lazlow Show here with sidekick Big Wayne.
Yeah, man.
Producer, sort of producer guy, Reed Tucker.
Hey.
And in the studio, Big Les.
Ooh, what's up?
How do I just describe you? I mean, like, what's your job?
My job, I've got 10 of them. Dance diva extraordinaire, choreographer to the stars.
You do a lot of time on the red carpet as well.
A whole lot of time on the red carpet doing interviews, press junkets, all that stuff.
Now, see, I've been on a few of those because I do the nationally syndicated radio feature about technology. And so sometimes we'll have like a big star in a video game or a big star to like launch something. And I got to tell you, the thing that drives me the craziest is the Japanese or Asian photographers will run you over.
Elbow to the neck, move out the way, kick you in the shin.
Bruce Willis was in some video game that failed. and I was about to try to ask him a question if he was going to be singing Under the Boardwalk in it. And he got a little snarky about that. But,
sure.
Dude, these Asian dudes behind me be pounding me on the shoulder. Like, get down, and all this.
You know
like,
how much money they get for those pictures to take it back to the Japanese press? Are you kidding? Let me work over in Japan. I'd kick you in the kneecaps quick.
Asian paparazzi?
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So is it like when you're on the red carpet, what movie premieres? What are you
I
doing?
I do everything. I do movie premieres. I do press junkets, so I get to see the films before, like weeks before they come out. And then we do what's called either a roundtable discussion or room by room, where they have them each in like a hotel suite. So we all go in one by one and kind of hit a circuit up. So I'll, you know, whatever movie was. I just did The Island, so I got to do Scarlett Johansson, Michael Clark Duncan, Ewan McGregor, one by one by one by one. So that's the kind of one-on-one interviews and everything. I get to get in everybody's business.
And you were on on the big hip-hop morning show in L.A., and it just exploded.
It was huge. I mean, I've been blessed. I've been on two of them, because Big Boy really still is, like, the number one morning show in L.A., and the only reason why I left is because they offered me middays at the Beat, where I switched over, and they gave me my own show, a bigger check, added a zero, and I was like, see, I love you, Big Boy, but I gotta go.
See, Laz? See,
now, this dump doesn't even have headphones. Are you telling me that hip-hop stations have got, like, nice studios?
Come on, man. Well, I can't say that our stuff doesn't go off the air, but they're writing checks. Believe it. When did you ever think that you were going to see not one heavy metal video on MTV? Like, I know Ricky Rackman. Remember, what was the Headbangers Ball? Gone.
Yep.
It's nothing but
yep.
hip-hop, and
yep.
nobody would have ever thunk it. It is ruling the world, and it has for, like, the last decade and a half.
I thought country music was real big there for a while. Remember they said it called country music is the new modern rock, is the new hip-hop or whatever, but I mean, dude, you talk to people that work in the radio industry now, that work in, like, rock radio, they get no respect anymore.
Oh,
it's,
yeah.
It's like nobody cares.
It's crazy. I mean, but country,
they want 50 Cent.
See what I'm saying? Because there's a story there.
Well, yeah. It's because everybody's shooting each other.
I know.
You ever been in a gunfight?
I've been to, like, clubs where there's been shootouts before.
Ooh.
But especially, like, New York style is different, because people are, like, in New York are not fazed. So you step over a body, tell the DJ to turn the music back on, and you keep partying. Like, that's just how you get
and
down.
L.A., everybody's like, oh, my God, my makeup.
You know what I mean? But then there's drive-bys, and everybody just, like, hits the ground and stuff. You know, like, they're real territorial over L.A. You can't wear certain colors. You can't be in this territory. Like, it's crazy. And it's like, you're a 40-year-old man with a, you know, purple bandana on your head. I don't understand. But they grow up that way. Like, it's in their family, and you're just like, okay, so I can't wear purple ever again? Come on.
Reed was saying that you slept with a lot of NBA players.
I wish I'd be a rich. I'd own this station if I did, believe me. No, they, trust me, they don't care. It doesn't matter that they're married. You know what I'm saying? They don't care. The groupies don't care, so they step to anybody because it doesn't matter to them.
You gonna drop any names?
Of course, Shaq.
Whoa.
Allen Iverson.
What did Shaq want?
Latrell Sprewell.
Oh,
Shaq was ready to have kids and take care of me. And there's a chick out there.
You could have been in that Bugs Bunny movie with him.
No, I'm telling you, because he just, you know, they can do that. They can pay for anything cash, keep it under wraps. They go all over the country in a season. So I was telling Reed, they have families in, you know, Sacramento. They've got families in Seattle. They have families in Atlanta. And until the will has to be read, these families don't find out about each other. Pay for everything in cash, buy a house. If I could have a kid by any one of these NBA players any given day, sit back and relax if I wanted to.
You are a hot mama,
Well, bless you, you know?
I gotta say.
And it's easy. I mean, I hang out at the strip clubs with them. I hang out at the gym with them. And I have access to a lot. I could write a book if I wanted to, or I could be sitting back and buy this station and 10 others if I was that kind of girl. My mother would
say, do it.
Yeah, really. I'm like, telling
and everybody's going, well, why haven't you done it yet? Because I think all disease infested. You know what I'm saying? I know like 20 girls in the room that they all slept with, who slept with Ja Rule, who slept with Jay-Z, who slept with DMX, and they all have the cooties, and it's like, no, thank you.
She's really dropping the bomb.
But it's the truth, man. You see them all, you know.
Tell me what kind of cooties Jay-Z got. Isn't he the one that was doing awful things to some underage girl? Who was that?
R. Kelly. Okay. You didn't see the video?
You're so
no.
White,
I don't go to the movies.
So white.
I'm not up to date on current events like
right.
that.
So what do these guys say to you when they come on to you? Is it pretty subtle?
They say, yo, I'm an NBA basketball player. What's up? Here's my hotel room.
What's subtle? What are you doing? Let's go back to the room.
Wow.
Hang out. Well, I got to go to Toronto next week for a game. You want to come? Well, me saying yes is not like I'm getting a separate room and, you know, I'm coming, I'm giving up something. My feet will be in the air when I get off the plane. You know what I mean?
Lazlow tries that with girls. He tells them he's on K-Rock.
Correct. Nothing. Don't even work with my girls. No. It's like, whatever, stupid. Reed's girlfriend, Yoko Ono, don't even listen to me.
She don't even listen.
She's
asleep right now.
Station no more.
Yeah.
It's terrible. Yeah. Well, so we should play a Jaguar Skills Adventure. This is like an ongoing radio radio serial that we've been doing. Like the old school radio serials where each week you would, you know, get a new episode. And so we say, you know, the Lazlow Show, and this is episode 7. We have Jaguar Skills. It's all archived at the website, lazlow.com. And there's also, Wayne keeps telling me that we should mention that there's t-shirts and hats there, too.
Oh, what a shill.
He is a shill. But this is a Jaguar Skills adventure. Big Les is the girlfriend.
What you saying?
Of Jaguar Skills. And this is, presently, we've got an animator on board and a cartoonist on board, and it's being turned into a cartoon. So who knows? Maybe it'll be on Comedy Central or something someday. But here we go. Jaguar Skills.
My name is DJ Jaguar Skills. Secret ninja powers are revealed to me when I hold aloft my magic stick.
Jaguar, 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 Jaguar Skills.
With my fly Ebony Honey at my side, and my friends, the mighty Fat Boss crew at my back, I battle evil.
Jaguar Skills, the funkiest ninja in the universe.
Jaguar Skills. Join our hero at his hideout playing video games.
I got some ill witchcraft skills going on right here.
I'm gonna whoop some elf ass.
Yo, speak.
Hi, Jaguar Skills?
Yo.
This is Tracy from Ninja Dispatch HR Department. Yeah, okay. I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm real sorry to tell ya. You've been outsourced.
Outsourced? I'm an irreplaceable ninja DJ nightmare.
Yeah, okay, well, ninja health insurance costs are really expensive, and your hash bills are through the roof. Grapes.
Listen, bitch, I've got glaucoma.
Darling,
I have been replaced, right, by a Mexican ninja. Who's ever heard of a bloody Mexican ninja?
Who ever heard of a British ninja, fool?
Look, do you want a throwing star in your face?
I forgot to tell your ass, your replacement has arrived, and he's wonderful.
Please, get your gloss on for the moment.
A Mexican ninja midget?
Oh, yes. Little people need love more than anyone.
Damn!
Bollocks!
Will our hero survive the outsourcing epidemic? Will the ninja midget get his girl? Will he find Bobby and Cindy lost in the Grand Canyon?
Who eats beans out of a flashlight anyway?
Join us next time for another Jaguar Skills Adventure.
Jaguar Skills! Jaguar Skills! Five gorgeous young ninja pimps protecting Earth's entire galaxy. Always five, acting as one. Dedicated, inseparable, invincible.
The Lazlow Show.
Wayne, try not to cough on top of Green Day, if you could.
You got
to
give me the signal.
The signal is you got your headphones on, and you don't even hear yourself coughing. It's terrible. I mean, you've only been on the radio 3 times. What do you think, Big Les? You've been working at radio for like 15 years.
But where's the cough button, man? You guys got a cough button.
He's got a cough button.
It probably don't work here.
Oh, I'm telling you. Now, listen, you've worked at a lot of stations.
Yeah.
How would you rate the callers? You've heard some of the callers, people calling in versus an urban station.
Well, the callers at the urban station, I mean, first of all, you get those callers like, this is a collect call from Rikers Correctional Facility. can't like to make a request from Pookie, you know. You know, somebody gets on the air like, yo, Junebug, you owe me the $20. Send me some money, you know, for my commissary. Oh, yeah, by the way, can I hear that new Jay-Z song? Click, you know, we get the real ghetto crazy ones.
What's the prison out there?
What is the prison out in L.A.? You're the worst.
San Quentin?
That's too far, though.
The county jail.
But jail is like a resort. It's like Club Med. They have cable.
I don't know.
Phone privileges.
I've heard some stories.
I mean, but come on. How many people, like, walking the street can't even afford cable, and they got cable in jail? Come on. See what I'm saying? Thank you.
It's right, the prison industrial complex. They're building prisons faster than they're building housing.
And they're making it comfortable so that they can stay there and off the streets. It's crazy.
Half the people in there are drug offenders.
Exactly. And other offenders.
It's like 98% African American as well.
Yeah.
There's not hardly any white dudes in there.
Don't believe the hype. Trust me, you haven't been watching those America Undercovers like I have on HBO. There's a guy who went in there, white guy, went into jail for forgery, and now he gets life because he had to protect his behind. He's in there for murder. I'm telling you, the system is designed like you go in for forgery, you spend what, 30 days, 60 days, or whatever the crime, a year, whatever it is, now you get life because you've had to force yourself, you've been forced to kill somebody to protect somebody from like running up and you know behind you and all that other crazy stuff.
Sure.
So it's very, very mixed. Don't get it twisted.
So Wayne is a carpenter. I don't know if you can tell, he's not normally on the radio. He's a carpenter, and he was at my house this week, and he took out my doorbell, and I was trying to figure out how come there's not, like, ringtones for doorbells, you know, like you have for your mobile phone?
Right.
You should be able to, you know, you could get, like, a Dukes of Hazzard. You could have, like, a Dukes of Hazzard doorbell.
But don't give it away. See, you can capitalize
on
that.
Something.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Ringtones, are you kidding? They're doing, like, whole Billboard Awards. People are going platinum off of ringtones right now. They're making, like, extra award ceremonies and money for that. So that's all you right there, Lazlow.
You think so?
I think so.
Here's what I think. I think there should be a camera out front. And so, because, you know, on your mobile phone, when somebody calls you, you can have a special ringtone just for them.
Right. Correct.
So you have a camera at the front of your house, and it does facial recognition, because that software costs like $50 now, and you get a $50 camera, you get facial recognition, hook your computer up to it. And then when Big Les comes up to my front door, then, you know, you get a special doorbell.
Yeah.
You like that doorbell?
I do, but I want Bitch Better Have My Money. That's the song you gotta have.
I think this is the first time that NWA has ever been on the
station. Wow, Wayne, you're a carpenter. That makes you good with your hands. Hey,
yes,
ladies.
Ma'am.
Wow.
You know what they say, let a carpenter put it in.
All right now, line up downstairs.
Did you ever, I was thinking also, that have the Chuck D alarm go off if your parents show up at your front door. That'd be good, you know?
Oh, my God.
I got a Chuck D alarm here somewhere.
Do you?
Yeah, where's my Chuck D alarm? Track 11.
Look it up.
Track 11.
Please, everybody run off the front steps of Chuck D alarm. You
can't. Damn! Damn!
What do you think?
That'd be hot, though.
But see, could you be upstairs and that goes off? You're like, no, my parents are here.
Exactly.
And then you gotta get out the Lysol, open the windows.
Hide the condoms.
Hide the condoms.
At your house, maybe.
Hey, that's right.
Wayne's,
Leslie needs love, too.
Wayne's a pull and pray.
And it's been working for me 18 years.
Oh, wow. You might want to check that out.
He's got his own parking spot at Planned Parenthood. He, like, rolls up and, like, the sign says Big Wayne up front.
Reserved for.
That's crazy.
Am I right?
No, it works.
You're looking guilty.
It works. Wow. I am looking guilty. I'm feeling guilty.
So when you were doing this morning show with Steve Harvey, he finally said no more. And
oh, it was a political nightmare. I mean, besides the fact.
How is it a political nightmare?
Because
the radio station.
Well, the radio station itself, there was a lot of problems with the union and the people who were getting paid. So a lot of contracts, not just on the morning show, throughout the whole station were audited. That means they had to give a whole lot of people retro pay. Everybody got a check because the contracts weren't right. And then Steve, of course, he's more of an old school cat. You know him, he wants to hear his old R&B music instead of, like, you know, Jay-Z and Mobb Deep and all that other stuff, and he wants to hear the Commodores or whatever. And so they go arguing back and forth. He refused to play any music, and he wants to talk and tell jokes. He's in the joke
telling
business.
A little familiar. And what happened? He got canned?
Well, no, he wanted out of his contract early.
Got a contract.
They wouldn't have fired him really if he had done something wrong, and he was he was at the line of doing something wrong, but they still couldn't. They would have had to, he got them for a whole lot of money, a lot of zero. on a lot of commas. Trust me.
Yeah.
Hook it up.
And were you getting some of that big corn?
Oh, yeah. Especially when he got out of his contract early. They had to kind of, all the rest of us who were players on the morning show, here's your check. Instead of keeping us for like John Sally's on the morning show now with Ananda Lewis, and John Sally actually wanted to keep the rest of us, but they were just like, oh, Steve's gone, so everybody goes. Kind of a bad taste in their mouth. So we all got checks too. I didn't have as many zeros as he did, but I'm not mad.
And since we got Big Les on the Lazlow show, we thought maybe we would mix a little Hot 97 with K-Rock.
Kick it.
And do a little Breeders and Snoop.
Get an attitude, pop it like it's hot, pop it like it's hot, pop it like it's hot. I got the rollie on my arm and I'm pouring Sean Don and I'm all the best cause I got it going on. I'm a nice dude with some nice treat. See these ice cubes, see these ice creams. Eligible bachelor, $1 million boat. That's quite a dude, what's spilling down your throat? The phantom, exterior like fish eggs. The interior like suicide wrist red. I can exercise you, this could be your phys ed. Cheat on your man, man, that's how you get a his head. Killer with the beat, I know killers in the street. It's gonna make you feel like you're chilling in the heat. So don't try to run up on my head, talking all that raspy shit. I'm trying to ask me shit. But my nigga best, they ain't gonna pass me shit. You should think about it. Take a second. Matter of fact, you should take 4B and think before you fuck with little skateboard P. When the pimp's in the crib, ma, drop it like it's hot, drop it like it's hot, drop it like it's hot. When the pigs try to get at you, park it like it's hot, park it like it's hot, park it like it's hot. Get an attitude, pop it like it's hot, pop it like it's hot, pop it like it's hot. I got the rollie on my arm and I'm pouring Sean Don and I'm all the best. Cause I got it going on. I'm a gangster, but y'all knew that. The big boss dog, yeah, I had to do that. I keep a blue flag hanging out my backside, but only in the left side. Yeah, that's the great side. Ain't no other way to play the game the way I play. I cut so much, you thought I was a DJ. Two, one, yep, three. SC&OOPDOG. I can't make it, just break it. And when I take it, see, I specialize in making all the girls get naked. So bring your friends, all of y'all come inside. We got a world premiere right here, not get lost. So don't change the diesel, turn it up a little. I got a living room full of fine dime bristles, waiting on the pistol, the diesel, and the shizzle. Cheese to the biscuit, now ladies, see the guess. Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot. Hips in the crib, ma. Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot. The pigs try to get at you. Park it like it's hot. Park it like it's hot. Park it like it's hot. Get an attitude. Pop it like it's hot. Pop it like it's hot. Pop it like it's hot. I got the rollie on my arm and I'm pouring Sean Don and I'm on the best cause I got it going on.
I know you know what I'm doing.
I'm a bad boy with a lot of hoes. Drive my own cars and wear my own clothes. I hang out tough. I'm a real boss. Big Snoop Dogg, yeah, he's so sharp. On the TV screen and in the magazines. If you play me close, you want a red beam. Oh, you got a gun, so you want to pop back. AK-47, now stop that. Cement shoes, now I'm on the move. Your family's crying, now you on the news. They can't find you, and now they miss you. Must I remind you, I'm only here to twist you. Pistol whip you, dip you, then flip you. Then dance to the smell of music we crypt to. Subscribe, get your issue. Baby, come close, let me see how you get loose. Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot. Hips in the crib, ma. Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot. The pigs try to get at you. Park it like it's hot. Park it like it's hot. Park it like it's hot. Get an attitude. Pop it like it's hot. Pop it like it's hot. Pop it like it's hot. I got the rollie on my arm and I'm pouring Sean Don and I'm on the best cause I got it going on.
K-Rock. Reader, tell me that William Hung's on the phone. Hello?
Not William Hung.
You're not William Hung. You sound like
One
William
time
Hung.
To go.
I'm not William Hung.
Say to go.
Huh?
Say to go one time.
To go.
Okay. Right. Now say, do you want starch on the collar?
What?
Now say, do you want starch on the collar?
I can't hear you because the music outside.
What's going on outside your house?
There's a block party. They're playing sucky music. I need some good music here.
How long have you had a speech impediment?
Ever since I was young.
How long have you been listening to the show, guy?
Hey, you can play me Guns N' Roses.
How long have you been listening to the show?
How long have I been listening to the show? Oh, yeah. Wow.
So then you know we don't play music.
Yeah, you do. You K-Rock.
Yeah, well, that's
this is
change.
The Lazlow Show, dude.
The what?
The Lazlow Show.
All right. I'm turning to it now, because...
Wait, hold on a second.
You weren't
calling
even tuning into it?
No, you got to play music right now.
Yeah.
But you weren't even listening
to... talking to you.
Well, because I had the radio off, but I need some good music.
Well, then go out to the block party and try to meet a woman. You sound like you haven't seen a woman since Reagan was in office.
No, I have a girlfriend.
Oh, do you? Why aren't you at her house
Stay
instead of talking to us?
She bangs.
She lives in Ohio.
One time, she bangs.
Huh?
She bangs.
No!
She moved.
I love my husband more than anything.
Which is why I was surprised to find her sleeping with the teenager next door.
Now I take each day one day at a time. I didn't know what I had till it was almost gone. Now I'm faithful and haven't terminated a pregnancy in over a year. I stopped obsessing about my weight. Now there's just more of me to love. They say America's fatter than ever, but when you're number one, it's time to celebrate. And why not celebrate with cake every day?
Celebrate cake.
K Rock, it is the Lazlow Show, episode 7. Still shocked that we're on the air, Reed. I mean, like, every week.
I keep waiting for that phone call to come, but so far, nothing.
I keep waiting for the hotline rang earlier. It was the guy downstairs saying there was, like, Chinese food or something being delivered. It scared the hell out of me.
Laz, what do you think of that? William Hung's a fan of the show.
William Hung. Wasn't that great to hear William Hung on the... Here, calling up.
Bless him.
So far, we've had... You missed it. We got an email from Carrot Top. He sent us a...
Oh, that's right.
He sent us a picture. I don't know what I did with it.
But real Carrot Top?
I don't know. The guy said he was Carrot Top and sent a picture of Carrot Top just to prove it.
Well, he said he wants to be on the show, though.
Huh?
What does that prove? Don't prove it.
I don't know.
What did he say?
I did. And if it isn't Carrot Top, and it's... I mean, it was Carrot Top all like buff
jacked
and working out.
Jacked up.
What?
But there's somebody sad out there if they're going to impersonate a celebrity and this celebrity
and
they choose
Carrot
is Carrot Top.
Right. Times are.
That's right. I would choose Suge Knight if I was going to impersonate someone.
So we got Big Wayne as sidekick, Reed as producer, and sitting in on this week's episode is Big Les coming out from L.A.
Hey,
who used to be on Hot 97 here in New York.
Queen's girl.
And she is a Queen's girl. Now, can you deal with L.A.? Because the place drives me crazy with the smog and the attitude.
I'll tell you like this. First of all, they cannot drive. There's traffic. 25 hours a day in LA. Traffic all the time is crazy. They've got like 5 lanes of highway and it's ridiculous. And it's like 10 o'clock in the morning, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 3 o'clock in the morning. Like, where are you people going? Don't you work? But there's something to be said about getting up 7 a.m. in the middle of January and it's 75 degrees outside. So I can't believe it.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
It hadn't rained since like 97.
Exactly.
I read in the paper.
Right. So it's beautiful.
And then a mudslide takes out Millie Vanilli's family.
Oh, the mudslides are ugly. Like, a house on the hill in L.A. is pointless. Like, you can just kiss your money goodbye. Kiss it goodbye.
Why would you do that? I mean, I'm sure the view's great, but you live on a fault line, stupid.
And your house is on stilts. You can see it while you're driving, like, through the canyons. It's crazy. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't do it. Ever. Ever, ever, ever.
So you work at a lot of music video stuff, like, back behind the scenes.
Yeah,
and, you're a dancer and a choreographer, right?
Right. So I've danced in a million videos, and then having to do interviews. I'm on video sets and stuff all the time. And trust me, if a girl wants to get up in the front, sitting next to the artist, there's a lot of lollipop licking going on. Trust me. You can see the trailers moving, and you know, you got to hit the bodyguard, and then his personal assistant, and then the stylist, and all this other stuff. And of course, the director. Exactly. You know what I'm saying?
I worked with the guy who was producing some Public Enemy videos back in the day, and he said that, like, Flavor Flav's entire neighborhood would come to the set.
Yep.
And they would have literally an order for McDonald's for like 100 people. You had to roll up to the drive-thru and like 20 minutes later, you're still reading that 80 Big Macs.
Now that's a posse. And then you wonder why they never have any money left. You see what I'm saying?
That's
it's
right,
all
man.
Coming out of the budget,
that's
man.
That's why he's on the surreal life.
Can you believe that? Him and Brigitte Nielsen?
I know. How? I think that's another publicity stunt. That's what we're talking about. Nothing's real, man. I don't believe anything anymore.
Nothing's real. Radio stations don't take requests.
Right.
Well, then again, if you're writing a big enough check, we all know how payola works.
It ain't no payola here. I barely even play what I'm told to play.
I know. They're cracking down on radio stations and the TV stations for like playing. Play my video. Here's a paper bag full of money. And then you
wonder why. Is that still going on? Because it was like when I got into radio... in like 92, they said, man, you missed the heyday, dude. The record rep would come in here and he would throw the CD down and he would put like a big line of cocaine on the top and give you a big smile and walk out and you throw that buddy on the air.
Whether it's cocaine or a paper bag of money or a trip to, you know, Paris or a brand new car that just happens to show up and the keys come up in an envelope, something is going down with the Get Down and these songs are in heavy rotation. Trust me.
Yeah. It can't be on rock stations because ain't nobody giving us money to play Aerosmith. I got to tell you, there is no money coming in the door. So, Reed, this week I tried to watch a little TV and it was like, every channel is 24-hour Cindy Sheehan.
Oh, she needs to be banged.
Uh-oh.
Cindy Sheehan.
Tear it up.
See, now the political lines are drawn in the studio, Wayne.
Are you all for that?
There's like pro. Come on, man. There's pro people. There's anti-people. And they're all going to Crawford, Texas. You ever been to Texas?
No.
Dude.
Yes, I have, yeah.
It is hot.
It is.
It's fire in Texas. Yeah,
it is. Oh. You know, and this whole week, there was a really cool thing on... The Daily Show, because anytime there's any criticism, everybody starts bringing up 9/11.
Of course, sometimes, no matter how good your talking points, no matter how many times you repeat them, there are still some dissenters and some non-believers. If only there was a way you could shut these remaining people up with some kind of emotional bludgeon.
The war arrived on our shores on September the 11th, 2001.
September the 11th, 2001.
September the 11th, I made a commitment to the American people.
September the 11th, 2001.
September the 11th, 2001.
You know, if I had a nickel for every time Bush has mentioned 9/11, I could raise enough reward money to go after Bin Laden.
Dude, it's just everything.
And what's weird is all those clips probably came from like a 2-day span.
No, it was a 2-day span.
Yeah, it's
just
crazy.
Like everything comes up as 9/11. And now that weirdo Ann Coulter, who is like one of the big darlings of
the right.
Of the right or whatever. This is why I bring this up. I don't like to talk about politics on the radio or whatever.
Right.
But this chick was all over the TV all week calling New Yorkers cowards.
You got to watch her back, man.
Calling New Yorkers
cowards. Seriously.
We're going to set up a cage match
she
with
said,
her and Big Wayne.
It, quote, it's far, it's far preferable to fight them on the streets of Baghdad than in the streets of New York where the residents would immediately surrender, unquote.
Hey, now.
Her being first in line. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, where did she live? In a townhouse in Alexandria, Virginia or something?
What do these people get on TV and just sit there and talk garbage?
I know.
She's trying to get a TV show, man.
I know.
Hey, book deal, all of that.
All you got to do is talk smack.
There you go.
How come, how come Flavor Flav doesn't have it? I've never seen anybody talk so much. I went to a Public Enemy show like 10 years ago, and that dude came out for 30, 45 minutes just cracked out babbling.
He never stops, ever stops. I mean, it's like he's got 9 lives. You know what I'm saying? You went from surreal life and then to him and Brigitte Nielsen. And then I think they were going to give him like another show or something. And I'm like, please, no more. I don't think we could take it.
Right.
I don't think we could take it. But hey, if they're giving you money, I'd sign up and do whatever too.
Do you ever get freaked out since you're on the red carpet all the time in Hollywood? You ever get freaked out at how short dudes are?
Everybody's short. Everybody's short and anorexic.
Bruce Willis is 2 feet tall.
Yeah.
He was like.
No, dude like sleeps in a matchbook. Oh, they all do. Man, every single famous person I've ever seen too.
Yeah,
you know,
they're just, little.
I think they might have some sort of complex, man.
So if you're tall, then you can't be successful unless you're a basketball player.
Yeah, it's very very rare that you see somebody tall. Because I mean, you know, they always give you that. Well, you look 10 pounds or 15 pounds heavier on camera, whatever the case is. But all the male actors are shorter than the women. So then they always try and pair. You know, I'm like, hey, everybody's the same size laying down. Can't we all work? Can you all just get along?
I love that thought.
Nice.
Me and Reed are really into the meth. What, just kind of following the whole meth? Is meth getting big in L.A. yet?
Yeah, it's all big. You know what they're doing, especially those spoiled rich kids are in the clubs doing their whole thing. Phoenix River, all that stuff. Phoenix River. See, I think I had a little meth before I came in here, too. But none of that stuff has stopped. They're still doing their things.
Crack.
From the chandeliers. I don't think about crack. It's not sexy enough. Cocaine's still going strong. Heroin.
I'm telling you. We played that thing before where it says that if you smoke reefer, it leads to the H.
The H. Oh, that's right.
Ecstasy, everybody's doing that. Like, yeah, that's like their sexy drug of choice.
Speaking of ecstasy, we were supposed to have Jaguar Skills, who plays, you know, your boyfriend in our adventure. He was spinning at a club, but no, spinning at another Jade Jagger private party.
That guy has a life.
And he's going to be on the show next week to tell us about this, but Kate Moss, out of her brain, comes up into the DJ booth and offers to sleep with him, and he says no.
Oh, I wish I was there.
Wow.
He says no.
But there's got to be something scary when a girl is ready to give it up that
easy. Ain't nothing scary.
Come on.
That's model booty.
You mean that? But that's like 10 condoms booty. Come on.
So? Whatever. Go to the machine. Give me a roll of quarters. I'll buy them all.
She's probably got crabs that need, like, water.
Come on. It ain't that bad.
It ain't that bad.
Come on. Stop playing. So it's that bad.
I'd hit that.
Well, and then you'd be at
the You should see some of the girls that Wayne would hit. They got withered arms.
You can find most
stretch
of them
marks.
In a burned out bus in Queens.
Bullet holes.
As he's told us many times.
Big Les, thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks, you guys. I love you. It's been real. And
thank you.
You brought a little flavor.
Soul to the show.
Flavor
soul.
To the show.
Let's get this Jaguar Skills off and running.
I know. It's trying. And those are all archived. Our website's lazlow.com. We're going to play the new Bloodhound Gang in a bit. 93K Rock. It is the Lazlow Show. Dude, the hotline rang earlier. See, I keep waiting for the head guy.
It was good news.
It wasn't. It was said, don't do that. He said, don't play the new Bloodhound Gang song. There was the first single on their album is unplayable on radio, but you can check it out at their website. But we do have another song from them that we're going to play. You guys, this entire time while we were playing that Chili Pepper song, we're talking about Big Les.
Wow. Wayne and I both have a little crush.
What a set of chocolate puppies on that one, huh?
She's hot.
Those are like St. Bernard. The little barrel around the neck.
But she tells it like it is. That's what we like on this show. She'll name names. She'll come on
here.
She
dropped a lot of quarters. Yeah.
Basketball stars
that amazing.
Have some action on the side. Like entire family set up nationwide.
But you got to give a lot of respect because she could have went that road and she chose the road to make a name for herself and some cash for herself.
My favorite part of the show so far is the Japanese rap. Can we bomb them again?
They're doing it themselves. They keep playing that.
It's terrible.
I need the translation of that. Any ideas?
I don't know.
You don't even know what the song is called.
Okay. But it's so weird, man. When you travel internationally, you see all these people that are trying to look like, you know, West Coast B-boys or Queens B-boys. It's like, dude, stop it.
It's huge.
Oh, Reed, I meant to tell you, I saw the craziest thing that was researching some stuff for my technology feature.
Mm-hmm.
Some people were complaining to their cable company. You know, a lot of people complain to their cable company, like Wayne was getting free cable for a long time, and they complained when they
complained about me getting free cable, not me getting the free cable.
Some people were complaining to Comcast, and so the customer service representatives were changing their names in their billing names in the database so that they started getting bills to Bitch Dog. Comcast has identified the pranksters. They fired them and apologized to people. There were also people who, when they would call to complain about their cable service, the people would change their name in the database to be, you know, various parts of the body.
Good stuff.
Yeah.
You got any names?
Yeah.
Well, no, I'm not going to say them.
Oh, yeah. The hotline will ring again.
Just junk.
Junk, right.
By the way, Wayne wants to do something on the next show, Reed.
Oh, no.
He wants to bring a girl in here.
Oh, yes. I think this is definitely ratings.
And do a piercing.
Do a piercing?
Down south.
Yeah, but that... Have you ever seen it? It would be done right here in front of us.
I don't think I want to take the show that direction.
That doesn't really play well on radio either.
Oh, it does. When she's screaming her brains out,
and we get to witness that.
I just don't understand that. I mean, that's like a new trend. Right. What do you just belly button should be like the demilitarized zone or whatever. Mm-hmm. That like everything below that's Fallujah. Stay out.
I think it all looks good, but I don't want it done to me personally.
Do you have a girl in mind? Have you been
No, that's what we figured. We could get a contestant in here.
Okay. What if somebody wants
How
to.
How about you? You got anybody?
No, I don't know any girls. Look at me.
Yeah, by the way, if you go to our website for the show, lazlow.com, you can see the picture that a fan drew. What I like about Reed's picture is it looks like somebody spilled a Diet Coke. Your face looks like somebody spilled a Diet Coke on your copy of X-Men 94. You're just like, you're that grumpy comic book nerd look, which is, I mean, he captured it perfectly.
No, I look like one of the Lost Boys. I like it, though.
K Rock's the Lazlow Show. Reed, I had the levels pinned on that thing. That like the meters were not moving at all. Really? You had it cranked a little loud.
Man, the end of that song was sort of gave me nightmares. A little German industrial something going on.
So I got a new song here from Bush. You know, you like some of their other stuff.
Yeah, I remember them from the '90s.
Yeah, like
Calm Down.
Yeah. Well, actually, this is George Bush. Somebody's assembled some. A song from his various speeches. Put the words together.
Imagine yourself heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Above us, only sky. Imagine all the people.
I would love to know where they got
the colored girl. What was the context?
When did Bush ever say colored?
I don't know. But you know, heaven and hell, you didn't have to look but one speech. It was like the first 30 seconds.
Somebody's got a lot of time on their hands for that one. Coming up on the show in a couple weeks, the Bloodhound Gang has said that they'll stop by. So I told them I would kick out their new single. I think their album comes out at the end of the month.
But not
what?
The band song.
Oh,
this is the clean one.
Ain't my job. Doing your birthday. Ain't my job. Doing your birthday. Anymore ain't my job.
By the way, if this were a DVD, this is the point where I give the commentary because I'm breaking into my own show that airs on K-Rock to give you this. Since you've been cool enough to download a little piece of garbage from my website and from the show that I'm doing on New York radio, I figured I'd bust in and instead of playing you the clean single that is allowed on commercial radio, that song that I was trying to play that I got a call during my show and was told not to play is called Foxtrot Uniform Charlie Kilo. And my buddy at the Bloodhound Gang sent it to me. So I'm going to include it in this file so that you can at least hear it. Support those guys. They rule.
Uniform, Charlie, Kilo.
don't you meet and know my intent? Though I'm Brazilian, wax poetic, so pathetically, I don't wanna beat around the bush. Foxtrot, uniform, Charlie, Kilo. Foxtrot, uniform, Charlie, Kilo.
I think I'm going to ban all songs that fade, Reed.
Yeah.
And just, you never know when to start talking. So this is the Lazlow Show, episode 7. The website's lazlow.com. You can listen to past episodes. There's actually a picture of Reed looking like he's upset about his comic book collection. Wayne has no shirt on. That's a good shot, Wayne.
That is a nice shot.
You know what? I can track how many people are looking at you with no shirt on that website.
Let me know the number.
So,
that one, yeah.
So last time, last show, we had a fan, a Marine, who said that he was listening to clips of Reed and I from GTA that he downloaded and was listening to them when they were invading Baghdad.
Grand Theft Auto and this, GTA.
Yeah, and this week we've got another Marine named Matt the Marine. Yo, what's up, Matt?
How you doing, Leslie?
Now, here's the weird thing. This guy says he's a Marine, and I see him in the clothes, but he's got an Australian accent. What? Are you Australian-American? Is that a slur to call you an Australian-American?
No, I'm Australian.
American-Australian.
But you're an Australian,
no,
but...
I'm an Australian.
You're an American.
But you're in the United States Marine Corps.
That's correct, yeah.
And you keep calling me... What do you always call me?
What I call you?
Yes.
Oh, you nasty civilian.
Yeah, he calls me a nasty, filthy civilian. He invited me over to the Tyson fight with a room full of Marines. Holy... Yeah, dude, those guys can drink. This guy made me a vodka. What was that guy's name that made me that vodka thing?
Oh, man, who was it?
He was passing out during the fight. It was your roommate.
Is that Paul?
Yeah, I think it was Paul. This guy, he filled a...
Oh, Paul. Yeah.
He filled a glass full of vodka and literally put like an inch...
Paul looks like that type of guy.
He's in a hole in Afghanistan.
Marines can drink, dude.
What was it called? Marine Kool-Aid or something like that?
Yeah, Marine Kool-Aid. That stuff was ruined. Now, you know, Wayne's been working on a little something.
Hey, Matt, you know the guy Ross, the Marine that was here last week? It turns out he's in charge of shipping guys out. And it looks like you're going to Fallujah.
Yeah, it's because Wayne has his eye on your girlfriend, you know.
I bet he does.
We see Matt at the beach every weekend, and Wayne cannot keep his eyes off her.
That's the truth.
And especially because he found out that she has a piercing.
Yes.
Up top.
Yes. And it was pretty obvious to me. Everyone else reacted like, oh, you can't talk
and
about
so,
that.
So Wayne is trying to find out if he can get you shipped back to Iraq.
I have a feeling you're going before next Saturday, the big block party. And there's going to be lots of tequila.
But right now she's got a Marine who's in shape.
Yeah.
Who fought for our country, as opposed to you, who has got a Rastafarian beard.
She's going
to
have a good time laughing anyway.
Before we let you go, give me the favorite phrase.
The favorite, the phrase that pays?
The one that you screamed out of the Humvee in Iraq.
Crikey.
No, not in the other one?
I don't know. Which one are you talking about?
We're looking for...
throwing another shrimp on the barbie?
No, we're looking for what?
We're looking for what?
We're looking for insurgents.
Oh, we're looking for insurgents.
We're looking for insurgents. I love Matt. Matt rules. Matt the Marine.
Yeah, Matt's got a nice package at home, huh?
Well, he's got to. What do you mean he's got a nice package at home?
His lady.
Oh, yeah. Well, you're the one that wants her.
Yeah, well. Unfortunately, I'm spoken for, too, but my eyes can still wander. And my mind.
I just think that's very
mean of you to wish him.
No, Matt's he's got a good sense of humor.
He's a good guy. And speaking of, Reed, I got a great spam this week. It says, congratulations, you've been selected to receive a free Christian t-shirt.
All right.
And it says, wherever I go, Jesus is with me.
That's what we need. All right.
Which makes me really nervous. Because sometimes
they're still tracking you down from back home.
Back in Oklahoma?
Yeah, he's the one who doesn't want you to play that new Bloodhound Gang song.
Well, yeah, I got kicked out of the church in Oklahoma.
Did you?
Yeah.
Tell him why.
You didn't want to handle snakes?
That's
another episode?
I'll leave you with this.
Maybe next the big Labor Day weekend show?
We'll go through that next week. I got kicked out of the big church there because I went to Sunday school on acid.
Join us for the